Hello once again, English majors. I'm Christopher Hanlon.
I'm Charles Warham. We're here with the Close Reading Cooperative once again for podcast day.
Your voice sounds different today, Charles.
It is. It's a dialect reading today here at the podcast. So I'm going back to the old home dialect.
You sound like the goalie for the 76 Philadelphia Flyers.
Well, that would be Bernie Parent, if I'm not mistaken, thank you very much.
But your point is well taken. Everybody has some kind of dialect.
We all do. Yeah. It's true.
And so we're here today to talk about dialect writing as another way for us to help you English majors build observations through close reading about the text you're assigned in class. Now, dialect writing, right, we all know what that is, right? That's
we do, I believe. I mean, I guess you know it when you see it.
You know when you see it.
You asked me to bring in something, so I brought in a something from Sir Walter Scott,
okay.
A novel of his, The Heart of Midlothian. It's a Scottish novel, and lots of the characters speak with the Scottish accent.
You're going to speak in Canadian dialect.
Well, I'm going to speak what I see on the page. Okay. Hopefully it'll sound Scottish.
Okay.
So, a character by the name of Saddletree, who is he owns a harness shop, and he says this to his wife, you know, kind of berating her for something she just said. "I tell you, woman, that ye ken nothing about these matters. Sir William Wallace's days, there was nae man pinned down to sic a slavish wark as a saddler's."
He sounds Scottish to me. That must be dialect writing.
Well, that's what we're supposed to sound like in any case. Such words like seek instead of such is supposed to sound more Scottish, you see.
Okay, so writers using non-standard constructions, non-standard spellings, you know, devices like this to signal us that the language they're writing diverges somewhat from the standard dialect.
Right, and he's sounding kind of, well, it's hard to say really what Sir Walter Scott was trying to do with it, whether he was trying to demean the Scottish, as it sounds like I might be doing to the Canadians.
That's right, because whenever you're talking about someone's language, you're talking about something very personal, obviously.
Right.
And I guess that's an important fundamental thing to note about dialect writing, that often, I mean, not always, but often, dialect writing is a way of signaling the reader that we have some kind of encounter with some kind of otherness happening in the text. Maybe it's regional otherness, maybe it's class otherness, racial otherness, you know, all kinds of reasons.
So the sound of the voice as you see it written on the page gives you an impression that you're meeting a different sort of character.
That's right.
That's what you just said, except I said it.
You said it
in a different way,
a different dialect. Right, exactly. So you know, I can think of an example of this that really sort of dramatizes this way in which dialect can, render dramatic this encounter with otherness. Okay, now my example comes from William Faulkner's novel Absalom, Absalom.
Now he's an American writer.
He's an American writer.
Okay.
And here's a paragraph that comes from Absalom, Absalom. And it's a little bit of setup though. This is a novel that concerns a family, the Sutpen family. And in this scene, a character by the name of Henry Sutpen is confronting a character by the name of Charles Bond. Now, Charles Bond plans on marrying Henry's sister and thus entering the Sutpen family through marriage.
Okay.
And Henry is intent on stopping that. They faced one another on the two gaunt horses, two men, young, not yet in the world, not yet breathed over long enough to be old, but with old eyes, with unkempt hair and faces gaunt and weathered. And then Wash Jones, sitting in that saddleless mule before Miss Rose's gate, shouting her name into the sunny and peaceful quiet of the street, saying, "Are you Rosie Coldfield? Then you better come on out, yon. Henry has done shot that dern French feller. Killed him dead as a beef."
Okay.
Funny stuff.
Right, it sounded very different right at the end there. You had a lot of different sounds, like killed him dead as a beef. That's kind of funny.
Okay. It sounds abrupt, doesn't it?
Oh, yeah. You can sort of tell that it goes from sounding like a regular old novel to somebody else's voice.
Well, and Faulkner's language, the narrative's language in Absalom, Absalom is so ornate and so often Latinate and so complex. And then here we have Wash Jones, who is a squatter on Sutpen's land and who represents that social class the Sutpens are trying to escape from, interrupting that flow.
So that represents some sort of conflict in terms of class or because of the registered, the way the language registers in your ears.
Sure, absolutely. Okay. And then, so dialect writing often does that, right? It tends to mark off certain speakers as other in some way. Now, another thing I think is important to note, though, is that the most masterful dialect writers are not just, you know, peppering their prose with a few misspellings here and there. Right? They're paying really close attention to the way that people speak and the way they sound when they speak. Okay. Mm-hmm. So Mark Twain, for instance, was a real master of dialect writing. And his novel, The Adventures of Huckleberry Finn, is entirely in dialect. Right? And you know that from the very first sentence. Right? And here's the first sentence of Huck Finn. And this is Huck Finn speaking. He narrates the novel. "You don't know about me without you have read a book by the name of The Adventures of Tom Sawyer, but that ain't no matter." Now, Huck's dialect is often pretty funny, but as I say, Twain was really, really, really careful about the way he depicted the way his characters sounded. In fact, he was so careful that he appended what he called an explanatory note to the beginning of Huck Finn. And here's what he says in that explanatory note about the dialect writing that he's doing in that novel.
Okay.
"In this book, a number of dialects are used, to wit, the Missouri Negro dialect, the extremist form of the backwoods southwestern dialect, the ordinary Pike County dialect, and four modified versions of this last. The shadings have not been done in a haphazard fashion or by guesswork, but painstakingly, and with the trustworthy guidance and support of personal familiarity with these several forms of speech. I make this explanation for the reason that without it, many readers would suppose that all these characters were trying to talk alike and not succeeding."
That Twain, such a card.
Funny guy. But he's being very careful, in other words, about his dialects.
And he's saying that there's four different dialects in one county? That's a lot.
So he says. All right. And so Twain is being careful about the way people sound, but I think he's being careful in other ways, too. And I think, actually, there are all kinds of moments from Huck Finn where we can see Twain using dialect to create, you know, all kinds of effects and effects of meaning.
Like what kind of effects?
Well, let me show you a moment, all right, from a little later on in Huck Finn.
Okay.
And it's a moment, I should set it up a little bit, okay? This is a moment that concerns a character in the novel who's named Pap. Now, Pap is Huck's father, and Pap is just an awful guy. He's terrible. He's just awful, right?
Okay.
Drunken, lout, violent, everything. And he's so awful that, in fact, when he arrives in town, he gets himself thrown into jail almost immediately for some drunken ruckus that he creates. And after he's out of jail, right, the judge who has convicted him decides that he's going to reform Pap. Right? He's going to, you know, reform him with love. Right?
Okay.
Right? So here's what Twain tells us about this. "When he got out, the new judge said he was a-going to make a man of him. So he took him to his own house and dressed him up nice and clean and had him to breakfast and dinner and supper with the family and was just old pie to him, so to speak. And after supper, he talked to him about temperance and such things till the old man cried and said he'd been a fool and fooled away his life, but now he was a-going to turn over a new leaf and be a man nobody wouldn't be ashamed of." That last sentence, let's talk about why is that non-standard? I mean, what are some of the reasons why that last sentence, be a man nobody wouldn't be ashamed of?
Well, it's, you know, what we was taught back in school. You shouldn't be using the two negatives in one sentence.
Double negative, right?
Right.
Right. So Pap is ungrammatical because he's uneducated, right? And,
okay.
And so he's the kind of guy who uses a lot of double negatives. So it sounds like he
would
sound.
Just like his character would be.
Right, right.
Okay.
I don't know if that's southwestern backwoods or Pike County or what, but it's dialect.
Oh, we use it back home too.
Yeah. What's he trying to say?
He's trying to say that nobody would be ashamed of him. He'd be such a good guy that nobody would be ashamed to know him.
Right. That's what Pap means to say.
Right, yeah.
But it's not what Twain means to say. Because after Pap says he wanted to be a man nobody wouldn't be ashamed of, he immediately, you know, that night, gets drunk, you know, wrecks the judge's house, you know, shows that he's never going to be reformed. The judge ends up saying that he reckons that the old man could be reformed with a shotgun, but that's about it.
So you're saying that Twain saying that nobody wouldn't be ashamed of him, me, and that everybody would be ashamed of him.
Twain.
The way they always tell you in school that if you use a double negative, you're saying the opposite of what you mean to say.
Twain means exactly what Pap says.
That's clever.
Right, right. It is clever.
That's close reading.
That's close reading, right. But, you know, actually, I mean, all of this, to tell you the truth, has been for me kind of in the tradition of Mark Twain, an explanatory note. I'm working toward the kind of dialect I really wanted to talk about today.
So all this has been a preface for something else?
Imagine what it's like in my classes.